Good morning to everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce the this morning speaker, Dr. Professor Daniel Komsky. He'll tell us about strontium ruthenium O3, which is a quantum phenomena, and then it's also a playground for viral fermions. Professor Komsky is well known since his times, his old time in Russia. Now he's in Cologne. And recently he has contributed to solve the problem of the calaverites, which got into the news. It's a compound of gold, tellurium, too. But he will not tell us about that. Today it was just strontium, ruthenium. Welcome.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Very glad to be here. I have been in Natal already three times. I think it's always a pleasure to be here again. Now, my topic today is actually, I must say that that's not really my main activity. My main interest and my main activity is in a rather different field and strongly correlated electron systems, magnetism, orbital, and so on. But I am now at the moment in Cologne University, I am in the experimental lab. There are quite a lot of interesting experiments carried out in our institute, so that's why I sometimes am involved in some field which I am not really so familiar with myself, maybe. So my talk today will be kind of partially, or to a large extent, it will be experimental talk. I will just tell you a few topics which were studied in our university, in our institute, also related things. And I have chosen, actually, things connected with wild fermions. But when I realized that actually, I thought that I will have something like half an hour. So I will probably include also some of the things which are related and maybe, but more connected to my older activity. That's actually my somewhat corrected title and also some correct spelling of my name, because in program it's actually somewhat misspelled. Now. Here, actually, at the beginning, I want to make even some historical remarks to restore some historical justice, so to say. And then I will just speak about the strontium ruthenate, some of the properties, and in particular, Weyl point Hall effect, and specifically what has been done in our university, role of Weyl points in magnetization dynamic, in spin wave spectrum, essentially. Okay. A few words simply about history, because I would like to use this opportunity, because there are many people here in the audience who are dealing now with different topological aspects of solids. And of course, all these things you can trace back history to long ago, and also Weyl fermions were introduced maybe in 1930s and so on. But recent activity in condensed matter started practically when people started to speak about what they call topological insulator. And that was one of the first, probably was the first paper by Kane and Maley, when they considered a situation when we have levels with different symmetries, with inverted symmetry, and in which case we have here the surface or the interface between two such materials, this crossing of this spectrum, which gives you, well, conical point, which may be Dirac point, or if it's T-symmetry is broken, then it might be Weyl point. And that was actually beginning of all the present activity, essentially. And then later on, there were also some other paper by the same people, or maybe Shuqing Zhang and so on. And the first real experimental observation of quantum spin Hall effect in this, it was a mercury telluride quantum wells in a group of Mollenkamp. It was a suggestion by Shuqing Zhang, but the experiment was done in Germany, Mollenkamp. As you see here, it's actually what is, it's 2005, 2006. But practically more than 10 years before that, in our, I am originally from Moscow, from Lebedev Physical Institute, from theoretical department of Lebedev Institute. And I had very good friends, actually. They were not even in the same theoretical department, but even in the same group which was headed by Keldysh. And here is actually a paper by our former co-workers, Lebedev Physical Institute, theoretical department. That was Bory Volkov, who unfortunately is passed away already, but Oleg Pankratov, he is now still okay, and he is professor in Germany someplace. And they, you look here, two-dimensional massless fermions in inversion contact. That was what it was actually, 1885. So more than 10 years before this. And you see here the spectrum, it's actually mutually inverted band, which give you this linear spectrum, and they even spoke about Weyl fermions, Dirac point of Weyl fermions. And people don't know it, actually. I wanted simply to use this opportunity to restore the, this truth about my former friends. And then actually the next paper was a year after that, same people plus some the students, I think, was. They specifically proposed same material like mercury telluride, which was used in the first experimental observation by Mollenkamp in 2007. So proposal was done really in this paper they already also discussed the same kind of lead, but it was not mercury telluride, it was lead telluride. But in next paper they even specifically discussed both lead telluride and mercury telluride. Contact containing two-dimensional metals, just read it, was sitting here. Fermionic state. And that's actually a spectrum, famous spectrum, which I will also use later. Sorry? Once again, I didn't hear. Well, might be. It might be not the only one. I simply know our people, actually, my former friends. Okay. Now, if you think about strontium rutenate. Strontium rutenate, are you have some questions? Well, I don't really remember all the details why they speak about supersymmetry, but probably they just discussed on equal footing both charge and spin degrees of freedom, that spins are intrinsically involved. But why supersymmetry in the title, I simply can't tell you. I'm sorry. Now, strontium rutenate. Strontium rutenate is one of the simplest structurally and turns out to be extremely interesting material. That's actually a simple perovskite structure, cubic perovskite. Ruthenium forms a kind of cubic lattice. It's metallic and it's ferromagnetic, with TC of order of 175, something like that. And that's actually used very widely now in spintronics as a source of, if you need some oxides, you need some super lattices of oxides, then you need some ferromagnetic oxides, very often people use this strontium. But it turns out that actually this property, it looks like it's a simple ferromagnetic metal, like Landau liquid and so on. But first of all, it was shown first by this group of Kapitulnik and all these Jebol and so on, that it's actually non-Fermi liquid behavior. So just look here. The charge dynamic is essentially absolutely definitely non-Fermi liquid. And the other paper is in which you immediately recognize one of the authors here, who's sitting just opposite to me, Fyodor Kuzmartsev, when they also discussed both experimentally and theoretically non-Fermi liquid behavior of this cubic rutenate, both strontium rutenate and calcium rutenate. Experiment was done by Bradarich and theory by Mukul Lat and Fyodor Kuzmartsev. So they just saw that actually all these properties, this fitted by non-Fermi liquid Now, actually, what is really a real origin of this non-Fermi liquid behavior? To my understanding, it's still kind of not really clarified. It might be that actually Weyl points, which I will speak about later on, play some role, but I'm not sure. I really don't know why it's really non-Fermi liquid. Now, another interesting effect, non-trivial effect, was covered when people studied structural properties. Structural properties are such that if you look at behavior of, say, constant as a function of temperature, then you see that usually, actually, normal behavior is the shrinking of thermal expansion. If it increases temperature, both volume and lattice constant usually increase. That's normal thermal expansion. Now, there is famous Invar effect when you change temperature, but actually lattice constant remains practically constant. That's actually what people call Invar effect, invariant, from point of view invariant. Sometimes there is even negative thermal expansion. It might be even more interesting, but already Invar might be very important for practical application. And here we see that actually above magnetic ordering, that's normal behavior, like normal thermal expansion. Below, there is this invar behavior. Again, why is that? We don't really know. We now just started to do some ab initio calculations to check what we'll get, whether we can explain it. But still, there is no big progress in that. And here, yet maybe one more historical remark, just for fun. That actually probably many people know about invar, but almost nobody knows who invented invar. That was actually this Swiss physicist Guillaume, and he got for that Nobel Prize in 20. Nobody knows actually about this Nobel Prize. That's one funny story connected with that. At that time, Nobel Committee was discussing it many times. People already proposed to give Nobel Prize to Einstein. And he was really considered this year as one of the main candidates. Instead, they gave Nobel Prize to this Guillaume, invar effect, instead of Einstein. It was really an interesting story. Because at that time, especially this Nobel Committee, they just were mostly experimental. They saw, okay, theory, you can invent any kind of theory. What's important is that's actually invar effect allows to make more precise measurement, because there is no thermal expansion of your measurement. If your lineal, for example, remains constant, and that actually allows to make more careful experiments. That's why they gave Nobel Prize to Guillaume. Okay, fine. That may be not so important. In any case, that's already two properties of this strong photonate, which are kind of unusual. Once again, it's simple cubic structure, metallic, very good metal, ferromagnetic, but non-fermi liquid, and lattice properties also doing something strange. Now, more interesting is when people started to study more interesting properties like Hall effect. That's actually a few slides simply just to remind you what is anomalous Hall effect. Normal Hall effect is actually linear in magnetic field, but if we are dealing with magnetic system, especially ferromagnetic system, then there is extra contribution to Hall effect, which is called anomalous Hall effect. When this whole constant at rho xy proportional to magnetization. There are different mechanisms, and that was actually a very hotly debated topic for many, many, many years. And first idea was proposed by Karplus Luttinger long ago when they proposed some intrinsic mechanism. And now, actually, that's the main topic nowadays, because it's connected also to the geometric phase and it turns out also to Weyl fermions. So that's actually intrinsic mechanism. But later on, people also discussed some two other mechanisms connected with presence of impurity, which are always present in materials. And for many years, actually, people mostly attributed this anomalous Hall effect to this impurity effect. There are two mechanisms. One of them, side jump effect, the scattering of when the electron scatters at impurity. Electrons, they spin up and spin down because of spin orbit coupling of this impurity. They scatter differently to the right and to the left. And here is more or less similar physics, but different treatment, actually, what people call Q scattering. Yeah. Now, it turns out that actually this intrinsic mechanism is extremely important. It plays very important, crucial, actually, role for this Hall effect, in particular in strong photonate. Here is actually, once again, some of the contributions illustrated maybe pictorially. In particular, for example, if you have skirmions, then they also can lead to deviation. If you have transfer electron with spin up, it can deviate in one direction. Electron with spin down can deviate in the other direction. That I will just comment on that later. Now, if we speak about intrinsic mechanisms, it turns out that there are non-trivial spin textures, in particular spin texture giving this what people call spin chirality. That's actually scalar spin chirality. If you have three spins, which form something like a solid angle, non-zero solid angle, non-coplanar, non-collinear, and also even non-coplanar, then this is non-trivial quantity, and that gives rise to extra contribution topological Hall effect. And that's actually illustrated more or less here. if you have three spins for mixed-solid angle, so that this scalar spin chirality is non-zero, then if electrons, if you have localized spins for such structure, three triangle, then you have conduction electron which goes around these three spins, and because of strong control coupling, it has spin this direction here, this direction here, this direction here, then it acquires geometric phase. That's actually what people call now Berry phase. And one can represent it in such a way that it's equivalent to the fact that there is flux, this is triangle, for example, there is flux of pseudo-magnetic field going in this direction. This pseudo-magnetic field was involved to explain this contribution to anomalous Hall effect by mostly by two groups, actually. One of them is this Alan MacDonald and Zinova, and another is around Nagaosa and Takura, Naoto Nagaosa. And they just considered, in particular in group of Nagaosa, they considered pyrochlore material in which there are two types of magnetic ions. Rare earth ions have strong anisotropy and neodymium ions. The rare earth and the molybdenum, I think it was transition metal. And then the magnetic structure is indeed such that they have this kind of structure of three spins. They explained it by this contribution, by this pseudo-magnetic field, which can be just generated by this Berry phase, by geometric phase. Now, actually, we were involved somewhat in this story, but from different point of view. It turns out that it's not just pseudo-magnetic field which is kind of manifestation of the geometric phase, but there might be real orbital moment, a real magnetic phase in such triangle. That's actually the paper which we did with Lev Bolayevsky, who many of you know probably. That's my old friend from Moscow. He was visiting Natal, actually, for several years. And then also two somewhat younger people, Christian Batista and Maxim Mostovoy from Groningen. That was published in this paper. And then I, if I have some time, then I probably will spend a few minutes maybe just to tell you about the story, because that's actually my own story. In contrast to many things which I'll speak about today, which is more like a review. And the question which we asked actually was the following, that suppose we have simple mode insulator. No orbital degeneration, no extra complications, simple lattice, non-degeneral band, one electron per side, and my strongly interacting interaction. So my effective U is much larger than T. Then in this case, standard paradigm is that actually electrons, first of all, because of very large U, one electron per side, are localized one per side. So charge degrees of freedom are completely frozen. They are out. What remains is only magnetic degrees of freedom. I create localized moment. This localized moment may point up or down, or may point have different magnetic structure and so on. So that's actually what remains, only magnetic degrees of freedom. And the question is there anything interesting in this limit of very strong mode insulator? One electron per side, very strong interaction. Is there might be anything interesting in the charge degrees of freedom? That's actually which we just ask ourselves. The standard wisdom is that actually there is nothing. And I myself am in this Hubbard business for I don't know how long. I'm already rather old. And if, for example, before we did this work ourselves, if someone would ask me if there is anything interesting with charges, I would say, oh, bullshit, nonsense. Charges are one per side, and that's it. That's the end of it. But it turns out that it's not the full truth. And there might be some situation in which we have a real spontaneous electric current and a real current, real orbital moment, and real magnetic field. Also some electric polarization. That connected with the same scalar spin chirality which I just mentioned. That actually applies to situations when I have not square lattice, for example, here four sides, but I have three sides. I have triangles. Triangular lattices are very well known. That's triangular, Kagame, pyrochlores, many other real materials having triangular lattice. And triangular lattice is supposed to be frustrated in a sense that if I have Ising spins with anti-ferrocoupling, then these spins are anti-parallel, this doesn't know what to do, up or down. But it turns out that it's also interesting from different point of view. That one can have more complicated structures. That's one of them with Eddickson has shown us yesterday, like, for example, spirals of different types. Then one can introduce not just describing magnetic state by average spin, which is actually, if it's zero, it's formally non-magnetic state. If it's non-zero, that's long-range magnetic order. If it's zero, but something interesting magnetic happens, that's this famous spin liquid. That can be characterized by a pair correlation function, which is maybe scalar vector product, inner product, this vector chirality, or scalar spin chirality. Scalar spin chirality is just this, what I told you about. This is solid angle made of byte of three spins. That may be positive or negative. Now, and the question was really, suppose I have this magnetic material with non-zero scalar spin chirality. What is the meaning of this scalar spin chirality? Now we know actually that it can give contribution to anomalous Hall effect, but we, at that time when we did these things, we did not really thought of Hall effect. We simply asked what can be non-trivial in this case. And then it turns out that there is something non-trivial. Now, suppose I have only two sides with strongly interacting electrons. Then I put one electron here, one electron here. They hop back and forth. And this gives rise to famous super exchange, antiferromagnetic exchange, second order in hopping, and in denominator as energy of intermediate state. Now, if I have three sides, I have a possibility that electron not only moves back and forth, but it goes in a circle. It may be clockwise or counterclockwise. But for that, it has to hop three times. So I have to go in small parameter T over U, which is small for me. I have to go not to second order perturbation theory, but to third order. And that's what we did, actually. We found out that this is general expression of current for this tight binding. And when we just considered this expression of current and calculated in the third order, you see it's even three times T. They may be even different. I don't care. T cube over U squared. And current is proportional to this scalar spin chirality. So it means that each time I have triangle with this non-zero scalar spin chirality, it means that there is real electric current running on the perimeter of this triangle. It may be again quasi or counterclockwise. And if it is a real current, then it means that actually there should be a real orbital moment pointing perpendicular to this plane of this triangle. So it's not just this kind of fictitious magnetic moment which people in this community dealing with well, Hall effect and spin Hall effect introduced, but it's real current. And that's also interesting maybe just to think what happens if I have, for example, not one, but two triangles like that. For example, I have same chirality, same current here and here, same chirality. Then you see that at this intermediate H, currents will cancel, but there will be current running on perimeter. Or I can maybe present something like this, this triangular ladder. Again, if I have same chirality everywhere, then all inner current cancel, but there will be current running on the boundary current. It reminds somehow, if you like, all this famous story about quantum Hall effect and so on. But that's really what happens in simple Hubbard model, but we have to have these plaquettes containing three spins or five spins, odd number. If I have even number, then by charge symmetry, electron hole symmetry, these effects are gone. So that's actually some of the examples of some triangles or maybe tetrahedra which can have, in this case, no current. In this case, there's the current in this orbital moment. And maybe if I have indeed some extra time, I can even say a few extra things which we studied by studying the same problem for triangle. It's not really related to Strong's rotate. I'm sorry, but simply just I think that maybe some people in the audience might be interested because there are some people dealing with multiferroic. That's material which are simultaneously ferroelectric and magnetic. And usually when people discuss this ferroelectric and ferromagnetic or magnetic material, they usually take into account some spin orbit coupling or whatever, or lattice effect. But here one can show that if I have triangle like that, and I calculate this time really charge on site. Then, as I said, actually, initially we believed, and I believe, for example, that in very strong interaction case, very strong, deep and mode insulator site, the charge on site is exactly one. Here it turns out that size is not one, but it has some extra contribution, which also depend on spin structure, but it's a different correlation function. It's simply not this scalar spin chirality, but it's this one. So if, for example, spins are such that S2 plus S3 are negative, so this is zero, but S2 S3 is maybe anti-ferrocoupling, then it might be non-zero. And looking backward, indeed, it's rather easy to understand. Again, the effect is of third order of T. So again, simple exercise, essentially. Mathematically, rather simple exercise. You start with simple Hubbard model on triangular lattice, on triangle, and calculate up to third order perturbation theory. We found out that charges are different. And backward, looking backward, it's very easy to explain why. Suppose I have, for example, this situation. We say spin down, down, and up. Then electron can hop on this bond, can hop on this bond, but it cannot hop on this bond because of Pauli principle doesn't allow it. So effective electric charge density on this bond and this bond will be different from charge density of this bond. So bond charges will be different. But it translated to the fact that also side charges on this side will be different from these two. Or actually maybe better state, suppose I have triangle and these two sides form singlet. So S2 plus S3 is zero. But S2, S3 scalar product is -3/4. So there will be different charge at this side as these two. But that means that there will be also electric dipole moment, which appears immediately as such a triangle. So in purely electronic system, without any involvement of the lattice, without any involvement of spin orbit coupling, there might be particular magnetic texture, particular magnetic structure, which give rise to non-zero polarization, non-zero electric polarization. That's purely electronic mechanism of multi-fluid behavior. And there is also one more. that's actually, by the way, some one material which has some similar structure. This is that actually very beautiful mineral, azurite, copper material, which is beautiful blue color. And people dealing with prostated system liked it very much because it's one of the simplest prostated material, which is one-dimensional prostated. It contains these triangles. And these triangles actually may have this singlet here, singlet here. So dipole will be altogether, will be net polarization in this direction. So there is real material like that. It's actually called another one, oichroite, or I don't know how to call it, which has essentially the same structure. So that actually this structure is very good to get this ferroelectricity due to magnetic ordering. That's actually nice photographs, which you have the same structure that you also see in nature. That photograph which I made myself here in Brazil, when I was visiting this Foz do Iguaçu, Iguaçu Falls, and I made this photograph. Simply like this analogy. And then one more comment which I can make here in this connection is that the same effect when particular magnetic pattern give rise to electric dipoles may be also important for completely different field, these magnetic monopoles. I will speak about monopoles later on, but that's actually monopoles. I will speak about monopoles in momental space. But you know that actually the story of magnetic monopoles is goes back to, I don't know, 30s to Dirac. And there are a lot of experimental effort to detect monopoles in nature, in high energy physics and so on, unsuccessful. But then there was a very nice suggestion by Castelnuovo, Messner and Sondhi. Actually, again, going back to history, exactly the same suggestion was done by Ivan Ryshkin a few years ago from in Chernogolovka. He only didn't use the word monopole. And actually, but all the mathematics, all the physics was in this paper, GTP paper, JET paper by Ryshkin. And I actually, I don't know him personally so well. I asked him actually, why didn't he use the word monopole? Because it would be really enormous response immediately. And he said, okay, the editors of GTP didn't allow him to do it because they said, ah, that's not real monopole, that's kind of some simulation. But these people were not afraid to use this word, and that actually gave rise to immediately to very big activity. The story is the following, that actually there are materials which are called spin ice, containing corner shaped tetrahedra, in which typically in ground state we have spin ice to spin in, to out. Spins are always pointing from the center of tetrahedra to the corner, but maybe along this direction, but it may be out or maybe in. It may be to in, to out. But if you make, for example, reverse these spins, then you make in this tetrahedra, you have three spins out and one in, and this will be instead three in, one out, then both these objects, which can be separated by just reversing spins along some trajectory, I separate this three in, one out, or three one out in, they essentially behave similarly to magnetic monopole. That actually gave rise to enormous experimental and theoretical activity. And why is that? By the way, it's very easy to explain. Suppose I have two into out. That's actually my magnetic dipole, if you like. And magnetic dipole I can represent as two magnetic charges. They don't exist in reality. There would be magnetic monopoles. They don't exist. But in principle, I can say that as though I have magnetic charge minus here plus here. Minus here plus here. And if you calculate total charge inside the tetrahedron, we have two pluses, two minuses. So no net magnetic charge. If instead I have three in, one out, then I have three positive charges, one negative. So it looks as though magnetic charges are not balanced, and then each of these each of these tetrahedra behave as magnetic monopoles. And indeed, it was really confirmed experimentally. Now, what I can add to this story is what I did actually in this paper in Nature Communication, is my story about charges. Here, this tetrahedra consists of triangles. And if I have, for example, four in, I use this expression, I see that all charges are equal. Or two in, two out, again, all charges are equal. But if I have three in, one out, monopole or anti-monopole, then charges on this side will be different from this one. There will be electric dipole pointing in this direction. If instead I have anti-monopole, there will be also this charge will be different from these two, there will be also dipole moment in this direction. So in that sense, actually, both magnetic monopoles and spin ice have also electric dipoles. Each of them should have electric dipole attached to it. And in our university, people really just saw some consequences of that and discovered this. Okay, that's more or less my excursion to sideways, and now I go to more or less closer to what I wanted to tell you about this transurbanite, in particular this anomalous Hall effect. This is actually a very active field now. People study it in films on multi-layered transurbanite and detect some very anomalous behavior. It's actually, there are many works like that, but these are the data from a young woman from our university, Janela Linford-Bergeau. That actually here you see this magnetic hysteresis and Hall effect, which follows exactly magnetic hysteresis. Looks like it's actually exactly anomalous Hall effect, which should be proportional to magnetization. But in different regimes, there is some extra contribution. Look here, for example. Magnetic hysteresis is simple hysteresis, but Hall effect has something like this, extra peak here, extra peak here. And there is very big debate, what is this extra peak means? And one of the options is that indeed there might be something like non-trivial magnetic textures in these films of transurbanite, something like skirmions. If there are skirmions, then they will contribute, give extra topological contribution to anomalous Hall effect, on top of this usual Hall effect. But that's still a very open and very hotly debated question. Actually, this experiment that I simply don't know the answer. And there is actually a very trivial explanation, but people who make this experiment, they realize that the explanation is possible, but I simply explain that's actually again the same story. Magnetization, simple hysteresis, and Hall effect is this extra peak. Possible trivial explanation is if you have a Hall effect due to two types of charge carriers, which have different width of hysteresis and different signs. For example, that's actually, I try to plot it, my wavy hand actually, I can't really draw better in this PowerPoint, but suppose I have two components. One of them has normal Hall effect like this, black curve, Hall effect like this. And suppose that there is another component which has smaller hysteresis and smaller value, absolute value, and opposite sign. This hysteresis is like this, green one. Then if I make some of those, then I will get what is plotted here by red curve. Hysteresis, then it's up, because here this goes up, so total will be up, then like this. So a kind of spurious effect. So in that sense, actually, it might be that effects, beautiful effects which they see here, might be still somehow connected with these two components physics. But as I said, actually, people in this field, they realize this kind of option. They say that it's probably not the case. They are more inclined to think that it's really topological, extra topological contribution to Hall effect due to some maybe interesting magnetic texture like Skirmans. But nobody saw these Skirmans in these transmutinate fields. So that's still an open question. Now, another problem is, as I told you, that non-trivial spin textures in like spin chirality in real space can give rise to this intrinsic contribution to anomalous Hall effect, not related to impurities. Not side jump effect, not not skew scattering, but intrinsic, due to some non-trivial structure in real space. Now, it turns out that actually even more interesting effects might appear due to some non-trivial structure in momentum space. That was actually also done in, for example, in this paper, and also in this paper by Burkov and Bergman and Chen, in which they indeed applied these ideas specifically to strontium-ruthenate. And experimentally, it was discovered also in strontium-ruthenate. So that's actually from this Burkov paper. If you look at band structure, you see that there are some interesting points when it looks like you have crossing of the bands, which may give rise to Weyl fermions. And that was argument that this presence of these Weyl fermions in spectrum of strontium-ruthenate may be very important in giving these special features of Hall effect in strontium-ruthenate. Now, why Weyl fermions may typically appear in ferromagnetic metals? It's not always, but it's pretty common. That I was explained very nicely in this paper by a group around Nagaosa. The story is the following. That suppose I have, maybe I even can even just draw it here. Oops, it's better. Suppose I have, for example, spectrum. Simple spectrum like this. Then I have ferromagnetic ordering, and then I have two bands, spin ups and spin down band. Now, if I have spectrum which looks, for example, like this, two bands, up down, and I make it ferromagnetic, then I can have situation which is shown here, actually. For example, up down goes like this, and down goes like this. For example, this will be up, this will up, this will be up, this will be down, this will be down. And you see that there might be crossing of spins up and spin down. That's single level, so that's actually this crossing is even not direct, but it's rather reminds you Weyl point. That's actually what is illustrated here. And system may be still metallic because there may be some other bands somewhere, I don't know, somewhere here or whatever, maybe anything you like here. But if Fermi surface is somewhere close to these points, one might expect something interesting, something non-trivial. Sorry? Well, that's actually, I will come to this point in a minute, actually. This is my next slide. Now, when one includes spin orbit coupling, then one typically opens a gap here. Spin orbit coupling mix spin up and spin down, the band M with spin down and band N with spin up, typically opens a gap. So there is no such crossing. But that actually was consideration, not my consideration, Nagaosara. Here, after you just take into account spin orbit coupling, there is coupling with three sigma matrices, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, and finally you have the gap, which is proportional to contribution of all three. And now, actually, gap might be zero at some moment, point in momentum space, because actually there are three coefficients, sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, and one can sometimes find, maybe not necessarily, but sometimes find point in k-space, kx, ky, kz, and from some point of ky, ky, kz, maybe such that gaps exactly goes to zero. That's actually the origin of real wild point. It might be zero, but at particular point in brilliant zone, not in all brilliant zone. That's why it's not really a kind of circumference, but in principle it's gapped due to spin orbit coupling, but the gap may go to zero in particular point k0, which is determined by the condition that this gap is zero. You can choose these coefficients. Oops. I don't see myself this red. Is this coefficient, these coefficients, one can choose them such that gap comes to zero at some points in momentum space. And close to this point, one can write down this standard expression like this. And this seems to be the case in strong solutions. Now, one more interesting point, which will be important for me later, not right now, but in a minute, actually, is the following, that close to this point, you see that there is intrinsic connection between momentum and spin, but one can also translate it into connection between spin and current at this point. Why? Because actually I can take in this Hamiltonian, for example, if I want to consider current, I make this standard substitution k, which k plus, plus charge times vector potential, and my current will be derivative of vector potential. So you see that effectively my current will be proportional to spin or to magnetization. That will be important for me in a minute, actually, is my main part. Now, why this wild point might be important for anomalous Hall effect? That's actually a general expression of susceptibility. Which has susceptibility. It can write down also, I can write down very similar expression if I have not spins, but I have currents here. Then it will be expression for sigma, for xy, sigma xy. Will be same expression. And if I take limit of omega going to zero, then I see here this expression in which you have denominator which is squared. And if I have some point when epsilon n, some point k naught, in which two bands come together, like in wild point, then the denominator will be very small and it comes in square. That's why it can give you very big contribution, both to susceptibility, both to stability and to sigma xy. That's actually what is also pointed here. This is susceptibility, but it's proportional to some coefficient times sigma xy. That's actually how just sigma xy behaves in Strong Routinate. Normally, and if it would be proportional, sigma xy would be proportional to magnetization, standard anomalous Hall effect. It should go, start, for example, from, okay, maybe again. Depending on the sign, I may expect the sigma xy is function of temperature. If I have ferromagnetic ordering here, Tc, and magnetization goes like this, and sigma xy should also go something like this, or maybe opposite sign, but monotonous. Here it's actually experimentally non-monotonous, it even changed sign. That actually was one of the first indications that something is really different from standard anomalous Hall effect. Now, what we did recently, what actually started, was started by, in this paper by Japanese team, they also saw some signature of this wild fermion in spin dynamics. That's actually something what we also did in our university. That's what I really wanted to tell you about, and that will be end of my story session. Now, as I said, actually, here we see that simply spin properties are intrinsically connected to the sigma xy. And vice versa, actually. Sigma xy depend on spins, but vice versa. Spin dynamic may depend on this sigma xy, and sigma xy depend on wild points. That actually what was first claimed in this paper. They discussed actually that if they have spin wave spectrum in ferromagnet. In ferromagnet is typically quadratic, but it's very often if you have anisotropy, it has some spin gap. And in this paper, they studied spin gap and saw that actually behaves in a monotonous way. It can be correlated to this sigma xy, to this anomalous Hall effect. Now, what we did single crystals, and have shown, demonstrated, that was actually the paper which was just published actually maybe less than a month ago in PRL by a group of Markus Braden in our university, and then our theoreticians actually was theory was done largely by him, Rosa. I contributed also. What we found out experimentally by Newton scattering in very good single crystals of strontium rutenate. We found out that indeed, actually, magnetic spectrum behave very different, very strange, in an unusual way. So both this energy spin gap behave in a monotonous way. Usually, usually spin gap. My energy spectrum is, for example, like D plus. Okay, how did we do? Okay. Delta plus D k squared. So that's spin gap, and that is actually spin stiffness. And they are both, in normal approximation, they are both proportional to average magnetization. And spin stiffness also proportional to average magnetization. So they have to behave also in a normal way, when I decrease temperature, they should behave, and usually they do behave like this. Temperature, TC. Both spin gap and spin stiffness. Here you see that actually they behave very differently. They have non-monotonous behavior. Both spin gap and spin stiffness also. Both behave in a non-trivial way. And mathematical description is that I can, in next slide, I show you the simplistic description. But in principle, it can be described by this effective action, in which I have to add this term, dx, dmx or dt dmy, or sx точка sy minus sy точка sx, something like that. And this gives rise to this expression for this Gibbs spin stiffness. So in denominator, I have these extra terms because of contribution of wild point, which are effectively proportional to sigma xy. That was actually fitted here to sigma xy. This red is behavior of sigma. Now, a very simplistic way to describe it actually is the following, that if I have normal Heisenberg model with some anisotropy, then I make write this effective equation of motion. And I get these standard terms like these, which give my spin stiffness proportional to Sz, plus energy gap, which is also proportional to Sz. But I have to add these kind of terms. And if I add these kind of terms, it's actually, I shouldn't add it in Hamiltonian. I have to do it in action. And then I write down effective equation by variation of action. But because Hamiltonian cannot depend on time in principle. But still, actually, effective equation of motion are the same as here. So if I write it down here, then you see that because of this S dot, I have some extra omega here. Then I transfer this omega term to here, to the left. And finally, my equation is such that actually my omega is proportional to normal expression divided by some extra term, which which is this one, and it has also some gamma, which gamma will be proportional to sigma x y. So that's actually how that was fitting, this fitting of experiment and sigma x y. So essentially, that's actually the end of my story. So what I want to say again, that strontium ruthenate seems to be extremely interesting platform, extremely interesting kind of test ground to test some of the interesting quantum effects. So it has this looks like it's simple metallic ferromagnet, trivial one, but it has non-Fermi liquid behavior. It has Invar effect. It has extra contribution to Hall effect, especially in films, actually, this, which we still don't understand what it is. And it has also wild point contribution in momentum space to spin dynamics, and not only to spin Hall effect, but also spin dynamics. And there is very interesting correlation between magnetic spectrum, spin dynamic, and anomalous Hall effect, intrinsic contribution to anomalous Hall effect. Now, whether this presence of wild point can have anything to do with this first two questions, non-thermic behavior of Invar effect, I have no idea, actually. In principle, I could imagine that if I look at phonons, if magnons are sensitive to this wild point, essentially that's actually what we are dealing when I wrote this expression for chi plus minus. It's bubble, electronic bubble. I have to calculate this bubble. That's actually my chi. But the same bubble, I have to... It's a kind of very hand-waving argument. I have no real justification that it's indeed true. But my chi is this bubble. But the same bubble enters also in the phonon frequency, in the organization of phonons. And it might be that actually spin contribution or spin components are such that there is non-trivial contribution here, but there will be only trivial contribution to phonons. I don't really know. We just started to think of that, whether there might be some anomalous contribution, which is has very strong manifestation in anomalous Hall effect and in spin dynamic, whether the same effect might also contribute to phonons. I simply don't know. That's actually an open question. But in any case, actually, that's extremely interesting material. That's what I wanted really to tell you about. That's it.